Sir, I will be back in a minute, sir. I just will go away and I will come back in a minute, sir. The participants are started coming, sir. So we have 2 minutes more, sir. Sir, we'll wait or we'll start, sir.
Yes, the chairman can decide.
Yes, sir. The chairman only I'm asking, sir. Sir, sir, Radha Krishna, okay. Sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Sir, I'm asking you only, sir.
As you decide, I'm ready. We can start also.
Yes, sir. Sir, now 11 participants means including all of us, 11 is there, sir. By 4-5, that another meeting would have been end, sir. So if you say, we can start, sir.
I'm ready.
Yes, sir.
I'm ready.
Yes, sir. On behalf of the organizing committee of IMS 2020, it gives me immense pleasure to invite the eminent professor, Professor G. Radha Krishnamacharya, to chair the session. He is a well-known researcher in the area of fluid dynamics, and he contributed a lot in the wings of biofluid mechanics. He was the former professor of NIT Warangal and former HOD and HOD of Department of Mathematics, NIT Andhra Pradesh. And presently, sir is working as a professor of mathematics at IIIT DM Kurnool. Sir, the forum is yours.
Yeah. Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers of IMS, in particular the Department of Mathematics of VIT, for giving me this opportunity to chair this session and contribute in my own way. Now I take the pleasure of introducing our speaker, Professor Saravanan, Professor Head, Department of Mathematics, Bharathiyar University, Coimbatore. Professor Saravanan, his areas of research are applied mathematics, mathematical modeling and differential equations, theoretical computational fluid dynamics, heat and fluid flow problems. He got his MSc from Sri Ramakrishna Mission Vidyalaya College and Arts and Science, Coimbatore, MPhil from Bharathiyar University, Coimbatore, and PhD also from Bharathiyar University, Coimbatore. He joined as a lecturer in 2005, was promoted as reader in 2009, became associate professor in 2012, and he has been a professor from 2015 onwards. And he held several additional responsibilities. He is a member of the Senate, he is a member of Standing Committee on Academic Affairs from 2017 onwards, chairman, PC Board of Studies in Mathematics, coordinator, SCP Center for Differential Equations and Fluid Dynamics since 2017, Head Department of Mathematics from 2016 onwards, member Project Implementation Group PARS from 2011 to 2013, is chairman of several committees constituted by Bharathiyar University. He has the experience of, in fact, he has visited several countries, to name few: Australia, Canada, China, Germany, Japan, Morocco, South Korea, and United States of America. He has won several awards and distinctions, to name a few. He won the President of India Award for Young Scientist of Indian Society for Theoretical and Applied Mechanics, based on paper submitted in the field of fluid mechanics in the year 2000. Then, Young Scientist Award by Indian Science Congress Association, based on the paper submitted for presentation in the area of mathematical sciences in the year 2003. Then he has got JSPS Postdoctoral Fellowship from Japan Society for the Promotion of Sciences Japan, long-term research for foreign research in Japan in the year 2004. He got Young Scientist Award, Indian Mathematical Society, based on the paper submitted and presentation in the field of fluid mechanics in the year 2007. He has got Fast Track Young Scientist Award from Science and Engineering Research Council India, based on the submitted project in the year 2008. He got BICOS Fellowship from Department of Science and Technology for collaborative research in Germany in the year 2010. And he has got full financial support from Korea Institute of Advanced Studies, South Korea, for participation in ICM field at CO 2014. Then he is you know, handled several sponsored projects. He completed 3 projects worth 38 lakhs from a CRC, DST, CSIR. And he guided 8 PhDs and 5 students are still working with him. Similarly, he guided 48 MPhil dissertations, one still doing, and he published around 60 research papers in international journals and one in national, several conference papers, total citation index 660 with H index 16 and I10 index 23 as on February 2020. He has got the 5 best publications are in industrial and engineering chemistry research, American Chemical Society in the year 2017, then one paper on proceedings of Royal Society in the year 2013, then one in physical reviews in 2011, then one in transport in porous media in 2009, then one in Journal of Applied Mathematics and Physics Springer in the year 2004. Resume speaks volumes about his capabilities. It's a pleasure to have with us today. I'm sure the participants to IMS were definitely inspired by his talk. I think he is going to talk on sharp nonlinear stability limits for centrifugal convection and porous media. I take the pleasure of inviting Professor Saravanan to deliver his talk. Professor Saravanan.
Thank you, Professor Krishnamacharya. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers of this IMS conference for their kind invitation. Let me share my slide. Can you see this?
Yes, yeah, sir. We are able to see.
Control L.
Control L, sir.
Okay. So today I will be giving a talk on nonlinear stability limits for a particular type of convection which is happening in porous media. So I will be giving my talk in a more general way. I will not go more specific, so that if anybody is interested, they can refer our paper and they can get some insight. Now coming to the introduction, actually, if you see the fluid flows which are affected by heat transfer, you have several applications for this, and that is why several researchers are working on that. Particularly if you take the convection phenomena, convection is a particular type of heat transfer where it happens together with the fluid flow. So you have several applications of convective heat transfer with fluid flow. So mathematically what happens is that if you take the fluid flow with convection, the equations are coupled. If you see the fluid flows will be governed by the momentum equation, whereas the convection phenomena that will be mainly determined by the energy equation. And if you take in particular the natural convection phenomena, these two things are coupled actually. These two equations are coupled. Therefore, in that sense, it becomes mathematically important. And here I will be discussing some convection problems which is happening in rapidly rotating systems. Now, the importance of rapidly rotating systems is that, see, if a system is rotating at a very faster rate, then automatically we will be having some imaginary forces called centrifugal force and Coriolis force. Because when we have a rotating system, usually what we do is that we will fix the coordinate with that. So the coordinate would be rotating. So the Newton's laws are not actually valid. We had to make some corrections. So we will be adding some fictitious forces called the centrifugal force and the Coriolis force. And usually the centrifugal force, you are radially outwards, that will be acting radially outwards. And I will be discussing the And one more thing is that if you have a rapidly rotating system, the centrifugal force which is being created that dominates, that can dominate the gravitational force. Okay, provided the rotating speed is high enough. So in that case, your centrifugal force will be dominating gravitational force. That is one thing. The second one is that suppose if we have microgravity situations or zero gravity situations, there also we have the gravitational force, the dominance of gravitational force. Sorry, the dominance of your centrifugal force. Now coming to the flow through porous media, actually, if you porous media is nothing but it is a medium with solid phase and the fluid phase. So if you see the conservation equations, those equations were obtained by averaging procedure over a particular representative elementary volume. Therefore, they are the averaged equations, unlike your equations for the fluid flows, like your Navier-Stokes equations and that. And in this talk, I will be dealing with the convection which is induced by centrifugal force alone. Okay, I will not be considering the other imaginary forces like the Coriolis force in a rotating system. So I will be discussing only the onset of convection, onset of centrifugal convection. So now, in order to predict the onset of convection, actually there are two theories are available. And one theory is your linear theory. The second theory is your nonlinear theory. And there are different variants of linear and nonlinear theories. And the important idea in linear theory is that in the case of linear theory, we'll be finding some minimum value of a parameter above which all the disturbances grow exponentially. Whereas in the case of nonlinear theory, we'll be finding maximum value of a parameter so that all disturbances having lesser value, they will be decaying. Therefore, the thing is that if these two limits coincide, if linear and nonlinear limits coincide, so that is an important result. Say, for example, in the case of Rayleigh-Benard problem, we have that result. That is, your linear and nonlinear theories coincide, actually. But that need not be. There are several fluid flows in which these two theories deviate. As an example, we can take the plane Paisley flow. Okay, there the energy theory, that is your nonlinear limit is very, very low when compared to your linear limit. Therefore, you have a gap. So that gap is called your subcritical region, wherein we cannot predict anything about the instability of the system, stability or instability of the system. So that is called your subcritical region between these two limits. Okay, now my plan of presentation is that actually I will be dealing with, I will be discussing the centrifugal convection, the onset of centrifugal convection in a porous medium using the Darcy model. And then I shall use how to include the Brinkman's correction and how to get the linear and nonlinear limits. And then if time permits, I shall go to onset of centrifugal convection in a magnetic fluid filled porous medium. So my objective will be to find the nonlinear limit, but always before finding the nonlinear limit, it is usually it is better to find the linear limit so that we can have an idea on that. So with having that one in mind, I shall proceed. So this is the physical configuration which I'll be considering. So here actually I am considering a very tall slot or a channel bounded by two vertical walls. And within that slot, you have within that channel or slot, you have the porous medium filled with some fluid. So it is a fluid saturated porous medium. And these two walls are differentially maintained. You can see that is TC and TH, where TH is the hot wall. And here we can see that the axis Z dash is nothing but it is the axis of rotation. So Z dash can change actually. So it is at a distance of X naught from your the center of the slot. So you have an offset Z distance. So this is the configuration I will be discussing. So I will be discussing the onset of convection in this particular geometry. So coming to the governing equations, these are the governing equations. We have the conservations for mass, momentum, and the energy given by equation 1.1. And you can see in the second equation, you can see the centrifugal, the contribution of centrifugal force that is represented in the last term. And the one thing which you had to notice is that there you can see a translation x minus x naught, where x naught is actually the offset distance. Now, the importance of this x naught is that, say, for example, if x naught is either minus half or plus half, you just see the geometry again. Actually, it is, I will be non-dimensionalizing the length so that your left boundary becomes minus half and the right boundary becomes plus half. Therefore, what happens is that when x is equal to x naught equal to minus half or plus half, or in the dimensional sense, if x naught equal to minus L by 2 or plus L by 2, we will be having a unidirectional centrifugal force. Okay. Otherwise, we will be having the alternating directions. So that is the thing which you have to see. And here I'm using the Bosinic approximation as we use wherever you have the natural convection problems. If you see these equations, and we have some coefficients, and these coefficients can be calculated using the mixture theory because it is a porous media problem. So so the values of rho cm, km, they are the they can be calculated using the mixture theory. And these equations together with the boundary conditions, if you solve those equations, you'll be getting equilibrium state given by 1.4. So if you see 1.4, it is a motionless state where beta is a constant. Your beta in TB, that is a constant. So it is a motionless state wherein you have a temperature gradient alone. You have a linearly varying temperature actually. Therefore, the temperature gradient is a constant. Okay, now I will be interested. This is the equilibrium state which is subjected to our stability analysis. Okay, so what I will do is that I will be adding some perturbations to this basic state or the equilibrium state. So the perturbed quantities are denoted by dash, p dash, p dash, t dash. So so if I substitute these things in our governing equations, I can derive the equations corresponding to the perturbations. And these are given in 1.6. And I will be using some transformation just for the sake of removing all those dimensional quantities. So I will be getting a system as in 1.7. wherein you can see the control parameter RC, which appears in our problem. So RC is your centrifugal Rayleigh number. Like in thermal convection problem, you will be having a Rayleigh number. So corresponding to that one, in the case of centrifugal induced convection problems, you will be having centrifugal Rayleigh number. So it is a centrifugal analog of the usual thermal Rayleigh number. So it is as usual, it is the ratio of your the buoyancy force to the viscous force. But actually here the buoyancy is being created by our centrifugal force. And one thing here you have to note that your centrifugal, Rayleigh number actually, through this number you can have a dominance of, you can see whether which force is dominating, whether the buoyancy forces dominating or the stabilizing forces like your viscous forces and the conductivity, they are dominating. And these are the boundary conditions. Actually, I have taken the Darcy model. That is why we have Vx equal to zero. That is your x component of V equal to zero. And as usual, it is isothermal. So these are the boundary conditions. And so first let me apply our linear theory. So the important assumption in linear theory is that we assume all the perturbations to be infinitesimally small, and we give some growth rate for the perturbations. So that is that is denoted by sigma, where sigma is your growth rate. Usually that will be complex. It will be a complex number. And so the governing equations become 1.8. Now we apply the normal mode the technique. So through the equations Vx equal to capital U into e power ikz like that. So they are the normal mode approximations. And if you simplify those things, you will be getting the amplitude equations that is given in 1.9. So 1.9 is your amplitude equations. And here I actually have taken sigma to be zero. So sigma equal to zero means I am taking the growth rate to be zero. You can actually, for this problem, you can prove that the exchange of stability is valid. So that means that if the convection sets in, you will be having only steady convection and not oscillatory. That is, you can say that the overstable motions are not possible. Therefore, on taking sigma equal to zero, you will be getting the amplitude equations as in equation 1.9. And as usual, the boundary conditions are that they are well known. We have already seen that is 1.10. Okay, now as we are interested in the critical centrifugal Rayleigh number, and one more thing which you have to notice is that 1.9 should be solved subjected to 1.10. Therefore, that is actually, it is an eigenvalue problem where RC is your eigenvalue. And as it is a linear instability theory, we are interested in finding the critical centrifugal Rayleigh number, and we will be getting the critical centrifugal Rayleigh number by minimizing over k, where k is your wave number. So RCL is nothing but it is the solution of your 1.9 and 1.10. So once I optimize with respect to K, if I minimize with respect to K, we will be getting the critical centrifugal Rayleigh number. So that is the threshold for your linear theory. Now coming to the nonlinear theory, we apply the energy method, which was developed by Serrin and Joseph. You can see the celebrated works from 1960s and 70s. And you can refer the book by Joseph. And what we do is that we multiply our momentum equation by V and the energy equation by T, and then we integrate over the domain. So you'll be getting equations 1.12. Now we introduce the energy functional. The difference between linear theory and nonlinear theory is that in the case of nonlinear theory, that is in particular energy theory, we determine the stability of the system based on the energy of the disturbance. So we had to use some representation for the energy of the disturbance, and that is given by this E of T. So E of T is an energy functional representing, it is a natural extension of your kinetic energy, you can see. And here you can see one parameter lambda. The very purpose of introducing this parameter lambda is that using that parameter, you can maximize your limit, because our objective is always to maximize your nonlinear stability limit. So lambda will be used for that purpose. So if you see the evolution of that E, that results in equation 1.13, and you can show that, and d over dt, that is less than or equal to this expression, where the quantity within the if I take RC less than RCN, this quantity will be positive. So, using our the Poincaré inequality, you can prove that for all RC less than RCN, the energies of those disturbances decay exponentially. Therefore, our objective is to find this RCN, because once I know RCN, then I can I'll be getting about the nature of our stability. So I had to find my RCN. Now, for finding RCN, we had to solve this variational problem, because it is nothing but it is we had to maximize this functional I by d. So for that, I will be doing some manipulations, and I had to solve the corresponding Euler-Lagrange equations, because it is a variational problem. So I had to go for solving the Euler-Lagrange equations, which is given in 1.16. So that is your Euler-Lagrange equations. And if I simplify the resulting equations, I'll be getting equations number 1.17, where pi is the multiplier, Lagrangian multiplier. And here I will be removing that. I will be operating curl twice as usual, and on applying the normal mode, I will be getting the equations for the amplitudes. So the reason for applying curl twice is that once if I apply curl, your gradient will go, and the second time if I apply the curl and if I use your continuity equation, I can get the vertical component alone, the transverse component alone. So which is actually your U. So that is the reason for taking curl twice. And so these are the equation number 1.18 are the amplitude equations. And we had to solve those equations subjected to the boundary conditions 1.19. Now, as it is a nonlinear theory, we had to maximize the limit. So I will be using the parameter lambda for that. So this is my optimization. So this will be my nonlinear limit. Okay, now coming to the, let me explain the how we have included the Brinkmann correction also in this problem. Actually, we usually include the Brinkmann correction if the boundaries are more sensitive, because Darcy law is applicable only when the boundaries are far away from your the region of interest. Therefore, in order to see what happens near the boundary, that is, in order to include the boundary effects, we have to include the Brinkmann correction. And so that is actually given here. This is actually the Brinkmann correction, that is your Laplacian term. So mathematically, what happens is that I am increasing the order of the equation by 2. So I had to include 2 more boundary conditions, and they are given here actually.
Okay. Professor Sarvanan.
Yeah.
Can you please wind up in 5 minutes? Then we'll take a couple of questions.
Okay. So these are our the terms which determine the nature of the boundaries. So accordingly, I can classify the boundaries into rigid and free boundaries. And for Brinkmann model also, I can do the same analysis, and I can get my eigenvalue problem corresponding to the linear theory and eigenvalue problem corresponding to the nonlinear theory. And I have solved these eigenvalue problems using the compound matrix method. I shall not explain this method in detail, but it is a method used for mainly used for stiff differential equations. And it is a generalization of your shooting method, which is applicable for our boundary value problem. So we have used the compound matrix method to solve both linear as well as nonlinear eigenvalue problems. And this is the procedure actually. I shall skip these things. And these are the results you can see. This is the result, that is the marginal curve corresponding to x naught equal to 0. That is your axis of rotation remains at the center. Here you can see the linear and nonlinear curves. You can see a gap between these two things. And they clearly divide, demarcate your linearly unstable region and non-linearly stable region. Okay, so you can see, and the curves are given for different values of Darcy number. And here I have given the results for in terms of critical parameters. That is the critical centrifugal rally number and the critical wave number. You can see. So always your stress-free boundaries are easily induced convection, whereas your rigid boundaries, they retard convection, onset of convection. And these are the results. This is an important result. This you can see the effect of x naught. So as x naught changes, as x naught increases, that is as your the axis of rotation moves from the left boundary to the right boundary, you can see that when x naught equal to 0.5, it is unconditionally stable. It is, if you see the linear limit, it says that the state is unconditionally stable, whereas your nonlinear theory doesn't predict that. So whereas if x naught takes smaller values, these two theories exactly match. So that is the result, and you can see the corresponding wave number. And these are the, we have done the same problem for magnetic fluid also. So they are the magnetically sensitive fluids. So only when you apply magnetic field, they will be, you'll be having a magnetic moment, and it will behave like a magnet. So for those fluids also, we have done the same procedure, and we have, these are the results. So we have calculated the critical values. We have calculated the linear and the nonlinear critical centrifugal Rayleigh number. So you can see in some of the cases, you have a gap in between them. So the gaps actually correspond to the subcritical regions. And so these are some of the results. So with this, I shall conclude. So the thing is that in certain, the conclusion is that we can predict by defining the a proper functional, we can predict our, in some cases, we can, our linear and nonlinear theories coincide. Whereas if X naught takes higher values, then you have the existence of subcritical region. So, and these are the streamlines. I can skip the explanations. And these are some of the references. Actually, the which I have presented, the results which I have presented, they have appeared in the Physics of Fluids and Mathematical Analysis and Applications, and then Physical Review. So for more information, the readers can go through those papers. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Professor Vanan.
Yes.
Now the floor is open for questions. We'll take a couple of questions, maybe one or two. Yes, the floor is open now. Yes, any question, please? Well, there doesn't seem to be any question. Yes, please. Yeah, I think there doesn't seem to be any question. Professor Sarvan, thank you so much for your wonderful lecture. It's a very nice talk and a very complicated topic. Stability problem and other two in porous media is very relevant in the present scenario. I'm sure it finds lots of applications in industries also. And you know, the references, the quality of journals in the relevant papers are published shows how, you know, what you call complicated these problems are and the type of applications they find in various physical situations. Thank you, Professor Varan, for your wonderful talk. I'm sure this talk would definitely inspire many of the young participants in the conference. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor.
So on behalf of the organizing committee of IMS 2020, I thank Professor S. Saravanan, Bharathiyar University, Coimbatore, for delivering the invited talk on the topic sharp nonlinear stability limits for centrifugal convection in porous media. I extend my sincere thank to the chairperson, Professor G. Radhakrishnamacharya. The certificate and the honorarium will be sent to you, sir, soon. Thank you, sir.
Can I leave now?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Vanan.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Professor.
So for the audience, as per the schedule, the next is a paper presentation that is available in a different link. So the links are already shared with you. So the session of competition paper presentation 2 in that IMS prize group 4, 5, and 6. So you can join. The link is given, and the meeting ID and password is given. Also, before that, after that, there is a cultural program between 20 to 21. So one of our professor, she made the cultural programs and it will be online. So I hope you will be enjoying the IMS Prize Award session and the cultural program session. So please join the particular link to join the program. Thank you all. So thank you, sir, Saravanan, sir. So I'm ending the meeting. Thank you all.